afternoon and thanks for joining us. I'm Judy Simpson. The temperatures outside make us want to stay inside with a good book. So today we have some great books for you that focus on gorgeous landscapes and beautiful flowers in anticipation of springtime. Joining me from the UVM Plant and Soil Science Department is Leonard Perry. Great to see you again.
It's good to be back, Judy.
There's so many beautiful books out there. How do you pick your favorites?
Well, there are just so many, and I guess it depends on what's your interest. Is the vegetables, the fruits, or the person you're buying it for? Flowers, maybe. Garden design, travel, cooking. There's just a lot of things. So I brought a sampling of a lot of these topics today to show and give some ideas.
Great. Where are we going to start?
Well, I thought we'd start with a couple of authors that are actually going to be speaking at a garden symposium at Fort Ticonderoga, we'll mention, this coming spring. First is Charlie Nardozzi. Many people may know him. Here's a book he's written. He's several of them, Gardening Month by Month in New England. So I thought this is a great one to start with.
Let me move my mug out of the way so
because,
people
can
see it.
It tells you each month if you're not, especially newer gardeners. And there's Charlie. I should mention he's got a great website, gardeningwithcharlie.com. You can sign up, you get his newsletter, blog, and you can learn a lot just online too. But this book has a lot of different features in it. Of course, a hardiness map. We wouldn't be have a book without that, and especially this time of year, that's important. But also a lot of useful information, like here's a plant spacing multiplier. So in other words, if you have a space, you want to know how many plants, well, just look at this, and it very easily tells you how many plants you need to buy, or how much soil or mulch you need for a garden.
That is very helpful.
How many square feet in size? Well, you want it 2 inches deep? Well, then you can figure out exactly how many bags you need to buy. So that's a very useful thing. So a lot of parts like that, nice photographs of things to do, like how to divide perennials here, using two forks back to back and showing that. Pests to watch for, a lot of biological control emphasis in the book, and a bit about pests and diseases. Here's an invasive pest, the Asian longhorn beetle, which has wreaked havoc in some areas of the country. Something to watch for, and they're really watching for in this country. So a lot of different things like this. And then each month has what to plan, what to plant in various categories. Here you see some annuals, but also edibles, bulbs, perennials and vines, lawns, ground covers, roses, shrubs, trees, a whole bit each month. You can learn what to use with that. So then the next book is The Complete Kitchen Garden by Ellen Ecker Ogden. And again, she's got a great site, ellenogden.com. You can sign up and get her information. She's an author, lecturer, kitchen garden designer, and this book's been out a couple years, but it's just great. It has a lot of great photographs. Here you see an example of boundaries or fences, as we might think of them, how to visually screen the garden or give it some definition, or maybe just to keep unwanted critters out. On the right, a trellis, just a little design idea with a bench, real kind of rustic looking, so really neat photographs for inspiration. And then she's got basically 15 different theme gardens, okay? And so there's like a nice drawing of the garden here. This happens to be a salad lover's garden, some nice photographs to go with that to really get you inspired. And if you look at that and then look at the next page, you'll see the diagram with the numbers and what's in each of those spaces, so you can plant by the number, so to speak. So, and that's the salad lover's garden. There, again, many more of these type. And then, to go with each garden, are recipes. So,
and her recipes are delicious.
So it sounds like you've tried a few. She says this is either a book for gardeners who love to cook or cooks who love to garden. So again, you don't have to be a full-time gardener, but some really great recipes on that.
Terrific.
And I should mention again that these two people will be, Charlie and Ellen, speaking at the Fort Ticonderoga King's Garden Symposium. It's the seventh one of these. It's on Saturday, April 7th. And she'll be speaking on, again, growing a kitchen garden. And Charlie Nardozzi will be speaking on growing berries for the edible landscape. Then there'll be two other speakers, Emily DeBolt on gardening with native plants. She's a local nursery person. And then Barry Genslinger, who's known as the bat guy, on 10 things everyone should know about bats. He's the only licensed bat rehabilitator in Vermont. And you see there, Saturday, April 7th, you can go to their website at fortticonderoga.org to sign up for that even now. So a lot of great talks and information to look forward to.
That's terrific. Now, you've often had the opportunity to interview authors who are visiting Vermont, and one of your recent interviews was with garden author Claudia West.
The first question I have is the title of the book. It says Post-Wild World. What is that?
Yeah, so in Post-Wild, we don't mean that wildness is gone. If we read that comes up in your garden, tells you that wildness will always be there. It's a natural resource. What we mean is the fact that about 25 years from now, 75% of all people will live in cities. We have very few spaces left in nature, on the planet, where deep and rejuvenating plant communities grow that balance the effects we as a civilization have on the planet. So wildness doesn't exist that much in nature anymore, which is why it is so important for us to bring it back into our gardens, because quite honestly, this is where large parts of our future nature will be at home and will live, right there in our front yards, maybe even our container plantings on top of terraces.
And it can be as simple as having plants that provide insects for the birds or pollinators, this, right?
Yes, so that's a really, really important point. Plants are the foundation of life. They produce much of the oxygen we all breathe in. And ecological plants are the foundation for insects that eat them, and then birds who come in later to eat the insects. So for us, it is extremely important to bring these plants back to make sure our planet and we as a species have a bright future ahead of us.
So in your book, you give some of the, you go into depth. What are some of these concepts, how we can plant in tune with nature and ecology?
So there too, I think nature, natural plant communities are the greatest inspiration for us gardeners. Nature is the best model, so we can learn an incredible amount from how plants already grow in natural settings and translate that into our own small or large garden spaces. And one of the primary principles is that plants in the wild cover ground. You hardly find any bare soil anywhere. When you go on a hike somewhere, you will find plants covering even the most difficult spaces. Sometimes they cover bare rock. So in a garden, that means that plants should never be replaced by mulch long term. You should always have a dense, thick carpet of species, maybe one on top of the other, in your garden to provide not only incredible beauty, but also plant a salad bar for insects and a sponge garden that soaks up the rain and puts the water right back where it needs to be, back in the ground to rejuvenate or replenish our groundwater.
And I think, you know, by choosing the right ground cover plants that cover the ground, that's going to keep the light from getting to the ground, which is going to keep those weed seeds from germinating. Is that?
You're absolutely right. Plants, again, are the best mulch on earth, and they are so good at suppressing some of the weeds that we constantly battle in our gardens.
Well, I know in your book, too, you have some pictures of layers, and I assume this is the one layer, and what's above that?
Yeah, so you can almost think about it like a lasagna or like a layered cake, where you have ground covers at the bottom, and then show your species right on top of that. That creates spectacular flower moments and your emotional moments in your garden. That's that second layer. And then on top of that, we usually use either trees, shrubs, or tall perennials to build the framework or backbone of your planting. So we have three key layers: structural, you know, theme plants, and ground covers that make the garden of the future that has that incredible beauty and wildlife value.
So I think, you know, looking at one of these, it looks like you have just a few of those structural plants that you put in first, maybe.
Yes.
And then a lot of that color, right, for the different seasons of color.
Absolutely.
And then finish it off with all that ground cover.
Exactly.
Is that right?
Yeah. So that's exactly right. And we want to make sure that all of these three layers, plants are balanced in this. So we don't have too many structural plants unless you're creating a screen, right? So you don't want to see your neighbor or some kind of infrastructure. Then you can use a large number of structural plants. But normally, to make the garden incredibly legible and beautiful, we try not to use more than 10% of structural species.
So that's
in
a great
design.
Tip. I know there's many others in your book. What are a couple other tips people might find in your book?
Yeah, so plant more plants is probably the key ingredient of the gardens of the future. Make sure that mulch doesn't replace your plants. You should only really use it at the beginning of a planting, temporarily, but then aim for covering soil densely with ecological plants that have all of these great benefits. In order to do this, it's really helpful to use smaller container sizes. You know, it's much more difficult to plant dense ground cover with 3 gallons, yeah? But maybe quartz or landscape plugs could be the solution, or even seed if you want to play with that. And then, you know, when you plant these gardens, it's important to think about plants not only as pretty ornaments, but understand that if they have ecological value, meaning if insects eat the leaves or if insects drink the nectar in the flowers, you can bring all that beautiful life right down in your, you know, terrace or in your front yard garden and increase your gardening experience even more.
Well, great, Claudia. Thanks so much for a few minutes today sharing some of these. I really look forward to really getting in depth and reading these in your book.
Thank you very much.
I also had the chance to speak with Claudia. Very inspirational. I bought her book. I love it.
Yeah, she was great. And in fact, one of the main things she was talking about, think about landscaping with plants growing in communities, is one of the gardening trends for 2018.
Oh, is it really?
So it's right on the money there.
So what do we have next?
Okay, we have a little book here called Gardenpedia by Pamela Bennett, and who's a Master Gardener Coordinator out in Ohio, and Maria Zampini. And this is great if you want to learn some terms, learn a bit more about gardening. So if we just have a few sample pages inside of that to see some of these terms, starting with bulbs. There's many, we've talked about bulbs on the show before, different types. Bush, slang term for shrub, just a few examples, but even some nice information beyond just what is a disease. You need a host, susceptible host plant, the right environment, and a pathogen to have a disease. So a real nice example of that. Here is an example of the mycorrhizae, or actually ending this chapter, the little fungi in the soil that help plants absorb the nutrients, those being the macronutrients, the main ones, nitrogen, phosphorus, and potassium. Picture of the tulip poplar, a liriodendron, L, on the left there. And so those are just some great ones there.
And I know there's some specialty gardens too, like the highline.
The highline here, we've talked about this on the show before, but by Piet Udolf, who's a world famous landscape designer, and Rick Dark, who's a very well known photographer and speaker and author. And just in a summary, this is a newer landscape park, if you will, in New York City on the Lower West Side, about a mile long. It's linear. It's above the city streets, as you can kind of see here, on an old rail line. That's not weedy. That's a natural native landscape. A lot of native plants in there. You can learn through the book and see the park through the seasons. It's the springtime here. You see those old rail lines. Another picture. Woodland scene. Again, this is above the streets of New York City. It's just a great place to go in summertime.
A little oasis, like the
compass plant, and then you see a bird on the coneflowers. There's a lot of wildlife in this garden. Love this as well. Of course, in the fall, you have the sumac and the grasses. And in fact, this summer, I'll be leading a tour there, planning a tour, and we'll mention the website in a minute where you can watch for more information on that.
Now, your last book also has to do with a tour?
It does. Great Gardens of the Philadelphia region. We actually had a tour last year, and we're going to have one there this year to the Philadelphia Flower Show. And again, website in a minute will have more information on that. But here is an example of when you open it, just half of the gardens that you can see in that area. Longwood Gardens is one we went to last summer and we'll be going to again. And just one of the world-famous gardens. They've got great greenhouses and conservatories. But this book is great because it tells you just how to get there, what's there, if you can, do you have food, is it accessible? Some pictures like the Italian Water Garden at Longwood, west of Philadelphia, the fireworks in the summertime. So you can see it through some of the different seasons. So this is just a great book. And if you want to learn more about these books, more books, and of course the garden tours we've been talking about, like the upcoming one to Philadelphia, which the registration ends end of this month. So you have to check that out if interested. But perrysperennials.info, perennial pages, is the place to go for more on this and the links to things such as the Fort Ticonderoga Symposium this spring we mentioned earlier on Saturday, April 7th.
And the tours too are a great way to go see something, but then also know what you're looking at.
Exactly,
and be guided,
you know, because you can, you know, learn all about these. In fact, the Philadelphia Flower Show is the largest such show in the world. It's won many awards for one of the top events in the world. But again, on that tour, we'll do have not only plenty of time to see that, but we'll have a culinary tour. We'll have historic site tour. We'll see Longwood Gardens. We'll see a great garden center. We'll have a speaker over dinner. So just a lot of different things on this tour, which will make it a little bit different and special.
Terrific. And once again, the website is for more information on that.
That's my Perry's Perennial pages, perriesperennials.info.
Okay, terrific. Well, Leonard, thanks so much for joining us.
Thank you.
That's our program for today. I'm Judy Simpson. We'll see you again next time on Across the Fence.